MedCram.com.
Well, welcome to another MedCram lecture with BoardVitals question. This question comes from the NAPLEX Question Bank. And the question is about digoxin. So let's get into it here. A 70-year-old male with a history of diabetes, GERD, and COPD develops atrial fibrillation with a rapid rate. After cardioversion, he begins treatment with digoxin. Which of the following is true of treatment with digoxin? Select all that apply. There could be more than one or maybe just one. So it's basically true/false. So let's just review briefly what it is that digoxin does. So if you can imagine a myocardial cell, and as you recall, in just about every cell of the body, there's something called a sodium-potassium ATPase. And this is a enzyme that is in the cell surface. And basically what it does is it maintains the fact that there's a lot of potassium inside the cell and a lot of sodium outside the cell. So the way it does that is by pumping in potassium and pumping out sodium. So that's what maintains this. Now, interestingly, what digoxin does is it actually blocks that pump. It slows it down. So as a result of that, sodium starts to build up inside the cell relative to what it would be. Of course, there's still a lot more outside the cell, but sodium starts to build up inside the cell. And as it turns out, there's another way of sodium to get out of that cell, and that's something called the sodium-calcium exchanger. So here, sodium can leave the cell in this direction, and as a result of that, what comes in is calcium. And of course, it's two positive charges, and that increase in calcium because of this blockage of the sodium-potassium ATPase leads to increase in inotropy. That just means the strength of contraction. So let's go over this one more time. So normally the ATPase, this is an enzyme that uses ATP, pumps in potassium, pumps out sodium. However, digoxin blocks this or slows it down, and as a result of that, the amount of sodium leaving is slowed down. Therefore, the sodium concentration in the cell increases, and as a result of that, goes down this concentration gradient and at the same time brings in calcium, increasing the calcium concentration inside, which leads to increased inotropy. So that's how digoxin actually makes your heart beat stronger. The other thing that digoxin does is, if you recall, we've got the SA node here and we've got the AV node here, and those, of course, are connected. And then you've got the His-Purkinje system. This is the electrical conduction system of the heart. These two areas here are susceptible and are innervated by the vagus nerve. And the digoxin levels, or digoxin, actually stimulate the vagus nerve and upregulates it. So as a result of that, you've got upregulation here of vagal stimulation using acetylcholine. And as a result of that, it should slow down the SA node and also slow down the AV node conduction, especially apropos when you've got a situation here where you have atrial fibrillation and all of these electrical conductions coming down, the AV node will slow down the conduction so you don't have RVR, or rapid ventricular response. So digoxin not only increases intracellular calcium, but it also improves vagal nerve stimulation, which in fact slows the heart rate down. Now, as it turns out, digoxin has a pretty narrow therapeutic window. What does that mean? That means if we were to look at a dose range of digoxin, there would be a very small area where we would actually get the good benefit of digoxin. And if we went too high, we would get deleterious effects of the digoxin. And if we went too low, we would get not enough concentration to do the things that we would want it to do. So in other words, what we try to do is we try to get the concentration of digoxin high enough for it to work, but not too high that it actually causes cardiac arrhythmias. That's what we refer to when we say that it has a very narrow therapeutic window. And exactly what is that therapeutic window? Well, several different publications and guidelines have said that that narrow therapeutic window for congestive heart failure is 0.5 to 0.9. And this is, of course, in units of nanograms per milliliter. So 0.5 to 0.9 is that narrow therapeutic window that we're looking at. And this goes along with the guidelines that are seen in UpToDate and also the American College of Cardiology. Typically, this can be achieved via intravenous loading, or it can be done by oral loading. The key, though, that you've got to remember is it's typically about 7 days until you get to steady state. Can be longer in some cases, but at least 7 days is the key. Now, as we mentioned, this upper limit of therapeutic window of 0.9, which is what we see right about here, if we go above that, we can see things like arrhythmias. And the interesting thing about that is that having a low potassium can actually increase that risk. So what you have to do is, if you have a low potassium, is you've got to watch this level very, very carefully. It doesn't mean that you can't use digoxin if you have hypokalemia. It just means you have to make sure that you're not super therapeutic, because the risk of arrhythmias goes up in that sort of a situation. The other thing that's interesting about digoxin itself is that when it's ingested, there are some medications that can interact with it. Now, there are, of course, like things like amiodarone and verapamil, which can increase the risk of arrhythmias. But in terms of medications for gastroesophageal reflux disease, which our patient has, there can be interaction with digoxin. Now, one of the things that I want you to be aware of is the difference between antacids and actually medications like proton pump inhibitors. Now, antacids neutralize the stomach pH, and that has the effect of increasing the pH in the stomach. Proton pump inhibitors shut down the ability of your stomach to make acid by blocking this proton pump, and that also increases the pH. The thing that's interesting, though, is that there's actually differences in how this interacts with digoxin, and obviously it's not through the pH. A proton pump inhibitor will actually increase the levels of digoxin because of drug interaction. However, antacids, because of what they contain, and these are over-the-counter antacids, they can actually decrease the bioavailability of digoxin. And so, as a result of that, you would have to take more digoxin to compensate for the decreased bioavailability when taking antacids. So let's go back to our question. And as you can see, we've got them correct here and correct here. Let's go through them, though. With A, an oral loading with digoxin results in steady state concentration in 3 to 4 days. Actually, that's incorrect. It's more like 7 to 10 days. B, patients who take antacids may require an increase in dosage. That is correct. We actually just talked about that, where there are actually things in the antacids themselves that will reduce the bioavailability of digoxin. Digoxin has a broad therapeutic window. That's not the case. It actually has a narrow therapeutic window. And specifically, that narrow therapeutic window is 0.5 to 0.9 nanograms per ml. And so that's the second correct answer. And we skip D, and let's read D. Patients with hypokalemia should not take digoxin until the serum potassium is normal. While we know that hypokalemia can increase the arrhythmogenicity of digoxin, it's not a reason to not take digoxin until the level is normal. We just need to watch and make sure that the patient doesn't become too high on the DITCH levels. So the answers here are B and E. Well, thanks for joining us.